So, this is the first course of this semester. So this course is called Burnside type result for fusion category. So here is a QR code created today for people who are not yet on the WeChat group. You should scan this QR code and then you will enter in the WeChat group to get all the information required for this course. Okay. This QR code is available up to March 21. Then I will have to create a new one anyway. So today, that was the first session of this course, will be dedicated to introduce the course. So we will provide some vague notion. We will provide the motivation. And in fact, the introduction will be quite long. It will take several sessions. And then we will start the hard part with a detailed statement and a detailed proof. Okay. So introduction. Introduction. So, as an introduction, I want to start by the notion of a representation group called the character table. And we will observe something on the character table. And this observation will lead to a theorem called due to Burnside. So, as you can observe, and I will put a picture of character table to show what I mean. So, as you can observe by browsing character table. Final group. Let me add the picture here. So which one? This one. So here I put as a starting point, a website online called group name, where you can find a lot of information about final group. In particular, you can find a character table of all the final group, I guess, for order less than 500 or something like that, and ranking less than 10 or 11 or 12. I don't remember. So you have the So this is the character table. These are examples of character table. Then what we want to observe here is that, so you have this, yeah, character table of one, two, three groups. This semi-direct product here, the symmetric groups for, and the group of alternating, the alternating group A5, which is simple. The observation is the following. So in the character table, I will not go into the details of character table. We are interested in this column. This is a column of the degree of the character. So this is a character here. Character, character, character. You have five characters here. And this is the degree of the character. which correspond to the dimension of the corresponding irreducible representation. Okay, so you have two cases. It can be one or greater than one, or different from one. The character of degree one are linear character because it is also a representation by itself. It's a one-dimensional representation, so the character is itself the representation. So you have, it can be one or it can be greater than one. And the observation is the following. When it is greater than one, for each row where it is greater than one, here, you always add a zero entry this row. So here, this is greater than one, you have zero entry. In this row, greater than one, zero entry, etc. Here, 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 etc., etc. You always have a zero entry for the row corresponding to a degree greater than one. And this is true in general. In fact, you can go to such website. You can browse the character table and you can check by yourself. It is always true for this example. And in fact, it is true in general and it was proved by Burnside. This is what we call this is one Burnside theorem. In fact, there are plenty of Burnside theorem, but this Burnside theorem we are interested in this course, and we will generalize it and we will apply it to fusion category. So let me write the observation. So as you can observe by browsing character table of finite group, a row corresponding to a degree different from one, corresponding to a degree different from one, always contain a zero entry. Always contain a zero entry. Okay. And we will see that in fact this is very strong. This has a lot of implications. If you generalize that to fusion category. So this was proved in general. This was proved in general by the mathematician William Burnside. So it's quite old, in fact. William Burnside. Let me mention, just for information, that William Burnside was born in this year, died in this year. So you see how old is this result. But the generalization we will talk about fusion category and fusion ring and hypergroup, etc., are very recent. So this theorem can be stated as follows. It can be stated as follow. The theorem. Theorem by Burnside. So I don't know exactly in which year he proved this theorem. In fact, I searched a bit before the class, but I found some reference or some book, but that never, I did not find the explicit year. In fact, Burnside write a book about theory in in this year, one, so maybe this result is in this year. So if it is correct, then the which date is this year? Before the first world war. Anyway, so as follow, any irréducible non linéaire yeah, in fact, I forgot to specify here. These are not just character, but irreducible character corresponding to irreducible augmentation. The trace of irreducible augmentation. Okay. And here, when you say non-linear, this is exactly what I said before, with this mean of degree different from one. Degree different from one. So any irreducible non-linear character of a finite group vanishes on at least one element of the group. On at least one element the group. So if you know a bit of character theory, you understand the relation between this statement and the observation we did before. But if you are not so familiar with augmentation theory, in fact, the entry of the character table here is the value of this character to the element in this conjugacy class. This conjugacy class. So every here you have written class, you see. So you have every entry here correspond to a conjugacy class. Okay, so you have a group, you have an element in a group, and you consider H in G, and you consider the conjugacy class of this form, G in G. This is a conjugacy class. And you see, the conjugacy class form a partition of the group. And this partition is symbolized here. So here, this conjugacy class, one element, it corresponds to the trivial group, trivial element, because if you have the trivial element, G inverse is always E. In fact, this will one here for any central element. If you have a central element, for any central element of the group, the conjugacy class is the element itself. So for any central element, you will have 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. Here, they are centralless. Only the element is central. But for other groups with a non-trivial center, you have 1, 1, 1 for any central element. And then you have non-central element. And so the conjugacy class has an order greater than 1, etc. And you see, if you make the sum of that, this is exactly the order of the group. Let me see. So here, the order of the group is factorial 4, which is 4 times 3 times 2 times 1, which is 24. And you see, 1 plus 3 is 4, plus 6 is 10, 16, 24. Okay. So you have this is it corresponds to a partition of the group. And in fact, the character is invariant on the conjugacy. So you only need the value on one representative of the conjugacy class to get the value for any element. So this realize all the possible value of character of the character on the element of the group. And so when we said that the statement any irreducible nonlinear character of a finite group vanishes on at least one element of the group. In fact, because this value is an invariant of the conjugacy classes, in fact, we only need it vanish on at least one conjugacy class. Okay? So, for any, this is non-linear because it is non-one, and it vanish here for the element of this group corresponding to this conjugacy class. So here you have 20 elements in this conjugacy class. So this vanish on this 20 elements. And this is always possible. Here you have 12 elements in which it vanish, also 12 elements, etc., etc. Okay? So this is the statement of Bernstein theorem. Okay. So let me check the sound. Okay. Let me know if the sound is not strong enough also. I can, I guess I can increase the sound if it is not. Anyway, so you have this Burnside theorem, but in fact, we will generalize that to fusion category, but more generally to fusion ring, and even more generally to hypergroup. And the notion of hypergroup is self-dual, in the sense that when you have a hypergroup, you can have a dual hypergroup. In fact, if you prove something on hypergroup, you get something for the dual. And so you can define a dual Bernstein theorem if the dual is Bernstein. But this notion of dual Bernstein was studied, in fact, at the level of group theory directly. In this paper, I want to mention here. So don't worry if it is a bit without details. It's only the introduction part. Here, the goal is to motivate the dual version was more recently studied in a paper by Isaac. So Isaac is a famous mathematician who wrote a book on character theory. Navarro, Wolf, this year. Before finishing the sentence, let me explain the intuition about the dual version. Intuition for the dual version. So dual version, which means you have the usual version. Usual is you have a degree which is different from one, and then you find something zero on the row. This is the usual version. Here. So this is different from one, and you have a zero in the row. And the dual version, you don't consider row, but you consider column. The dual. So you have something. So here the condition was non degree different from one. For the dual, we will have another condition. I will not write here. But you have something on dual. And you so the colon. So it colon. I don't know how to write that. Okay. So you have to identify, you have to describe. So yeah, here for the group, you have to characterize in some sense the conjugacy class for which you always, for which there always exists a character vanishing on this class. So you see, it's a dual. Here you see there existence of a zero on the row. Here existence of a zero on the column. So plus. So I don't know how to write. Plus extra condition, with extra condition. With extra condition. So a specific column, like here, it's a specific row. Maybe I can write like that, row with D different from one. With different from one. And here, for the dual, you have a colon, and you have the analogous of this D different from one. In the dual, so you understand the intuition of the dual. You consider the colon instead of the row. Okay. So this was studied by these people. So that published this paper. So describing the dual version was more recently studied. Than that. Describing the group element. In fact, the conjugacy classes vanishing on at least one character, one irreducible character, one irreducible character. So the main problem here is how to write what is the analogous of degree different from one of row but for the column. So we will explain that later. Okay. So now let me mention. So this is about the dual. So we will provide two generalizations. One generalization to fusion category, generally to fusion ring or hypergroup, and also one generalization of the dual. So we will provide the dual version to the hypergroup framework. So the fusion ring framework alone cannot provide a dual version. This is thanks to the hypergroup framework, we can formulate a dual version which will make sense even at the fusion category level and which will provide some application, in particular to modular fusion category. Because, as we will explain, the rotated ring of a modular fusion category is self-dual in some sense, we will explain. Okay, so first let me mention some extension of the usual Bernstein theorem to Plus jeune catégorie. Burnside. Burnside Result was extended to all weekly integral fusion category. Weekly integral fusion category. Categories. Here, when you say extended, how do you understand extended? Here, this version corresponds to the is extension for the case RepG. So RepG, the fusion category RepG is weakly integral. In fact, it is integral. It's an integral fusion category. So it is contained in this class of, in the class of weakly integral fusion category. The weakly integral mean that the Frobenius Perron dimension of the fusion category is an integer. Here, the Frobenius Perron dimension for RepG correspond to the order of the group, which is an integer, no problem. So Burnside result was extended to all weakly integral fusion category. So for people who don't know some notion, for example, fusion category of fusion ring hypergroup, don't worry, we will define that in details later. So Burnside result was extended to all weakly integral fusion categories. Initially, in the context of modular category, initially in the modular case, the modular case. By a paper by Gelacky, Naidu, Nikshish, 2009. So you see it's much more recent. And in general, and subsequently, after that, subsequently, in the general case, so general weakly integral fusion category, not just modular weakly integral fusion category, by Sébastien Bourtiou, 2023, which is, so I am co-author. Not of this result, but the course I am doing now is covering a paper, and I am a co-author of this paper with Sébastien Bourse. So he proved before our collaboration, he proved already generalized Burnside result to general weakly integral fusion category. And maybe we should have time today in the introduction. In fact, in this course, in this paper, we came after that, we generalize that to some specific fusion ring and more generally to some specific hypergroup, recovering, in fact, the categorical case. Okay, so this is the next point I want to explain. The goal of the course, goal of the course Next time, downside result. To a large class of fusion ring. To a large class of fusion ring. Or, more generally, large class of hypergroup. Not every hypergroup, but a large class of hypergroup. I will define what is hypergroup. So note that, in fact, the Burnside result cannot be handed to every fusion ring, not even to every commutative fusion ring, but not even to every weakly integral fusion ring. But it extends every weakly integral fusion category. So, this Burnside property is a criterion, a categorification criterion, in the sense that if a fusion ring do not have the Burnside property, then it cannot be categorified. So this is this kind of application we are interested in. Of course, yeah. Okay. So extend Burnside result to a large class of fusion ring and more generally of hypergroup together with the dual version. Dual version. And finally, provide application to fusion category. Provide, the goal is to provide application to fusion category theory. In particular, categorification criterion. Criteria, but not just that. Will move, in fact, some result involving the prime factor of modular integral modular fusion category or something like that, the square free factor, etc. We will explain that later. Okay. So I already said orally the motivation for hypergroup, but let me write it down here. Let me check the time for the pause. It is at yeah, the pause is in 8 minutes. Okay. So motivation for hypergroup. Let me rewrite the motivation for hypergroup. Motivations for hypergroup. As we will see, the notion of hypergroup is more general. It's a general relation of the notion of fusion ring. Or you can say the fusion ring is some kind of specific hypergroup. So it's more general. So when you try to prove thing for something for hypergroup, it's a little bit more technical, a little bit more complex. So you can ask yourself, what's the point of going into such complexity? The point is that there is a notion of of dual of fusion ring. And in fact, this dual is not a fusion ring, it's an hypergroup. But the notion of hypergroup is self-dual. So the dual of an hypergroup is an hypergroup. So if you want to work with a dual fusion ring, and in fact the statement of Burnside and also dual Burnside, in fact not just dual Burnside, but even Burnside statement for general fusion category, involves the dual. Because as you said in the character, this involves both here for usual Burnside. If this is different from one, you can find one entry which is zero. So one entry here correspond to, it's like if you said there's one column for which the intersection of this column and this row is zero. And when you see column here, this involves the dual. That's why you need to consider the dual. So this is one motivation for, in fact, this kind of result are more natural to be stated and proved in the framework of hypergroup, even if it is a little bit more technical. And it's, I don't want an open problem, but it's a challenge whether all what we will explain, all the application for fusion ring and fusion category can be reformulated without considering hypergroup. It's not clear that the notion of a group can be avoided. It will be, in some sense, better to avoid it because it will be less complicated. But the problem is, can we avoid it? It's not clear we can avoid it. So in this paper, in this course, we will not avoid it. We will provide everything in this more general framework. But can we avoid it? It's a good question. So in general, the dual of a fusion of a fusion ring is not a fusion ring, but an hypergroup. But an hypergroup. Which is abelian and normalizable. So we explain what is but an abelian normalizable hypergroup. And the class, the class of hypergroup is closed under duality, and the class okay. So let me check the sound again. Sound working? Yeah, okay. So sorry for the technical problem. So I was in the middle of a sentence when the Zoom cut. So let me restate the sentence from the beginning. In general, the dual of a fusion ring is not a fusion ring, but an abelian normalizable hypergroup. And I will explain what is an hypergroup and what is abelian normalizable hypergroup. And the class of hypergroup, the class of hypergroup is closed and dual. So, let me just briefly mention what we mean by dual. Dual mean, so you have, if you know what is a fusion ring, you have a fusion ring, you have a basis. I will recall what is a fusion ring and what is more generally a hypergroup, but you have an algebra with a basis, and the dual, it's like a dual basis. Yeah, you have a, so let me check, made by the set of characters. So the dual does follow where the basis is a set of characters. The set of characters. And here we are not talking about characters in the, in some sense, but when you talk about character table before, here character was trace of irreducible operation. Here, the character of fusion ring or the character of an hypergroup are characters are one-dimensional representation. They are ring homomorphism. So you should be careful when you talk about character. Sometimes it's called it means a trace of irreducible partition, and this is not a ring homomorphism under for a fusion ring. But here we are talking about the set of character in the sense of the set of homomorphism. When you consider a rep G, when you consider a group, if you consider the category of representation of a group, the trace of the irreducible are the character in the sense we mentioned before with the character table. But the Grothendieck ring of rep G is a fusion ring, and this fusion ring has character in the sense of ring homomorphism, and this corresponds to the column of the character table, not of the line. So there is a confusion in the notation. Okay. Okay. So. So the extension. The extension of Burnside results to hypergroup permit to deduce the extension of Burnside result to Burnside. Wait, no, not like that. But Burnside statement, Burnside property involve the dual, so it is more convenient, more natural to prove it In the general framework, framework of hypergroup, and it will also provide automatically, in some sense, the dual version. Okay. But as I said, one problem is whether we can avoid the use of hypergroup to get the application to fusion ring and fusion category. It's not clear. It's not clear, even if it is possible, it's not clear that it will be less complex. In fact, it may be some, yeah, it's not clear. It's not clear that we can do that, even if we can do that, it's not clear we should do that. But it, yeah, not clear. Not clear. Not clear that we can do that. Or if we can that we should do. It's not clear. Anyway, in this course we will use this this context, this framework. Okay. So so now we will, so don't worry again if do not worry, the new some new notion mentioned above, will be defined properly later. We are in the introduction part. Will be properly defined later. And in fact, we will start now with the notion of hypergroup. Okay, so I saw that two people joined the WeChat group. So let me just 1 minute put the QR code. If more people want to join the WeChat group, so let me put it for 1 minute. Yeah. So I guess, yeah, the display is too. This is too large. Maybe I should reduce a bit. What about that? Maybe it should be better. Ok. So, let me continue. Okay, so now we will define the notion of hypergroup. So this something will be defined in details in the introduction. Some other thing will not be defined in the introduction. So let H be a finite dimensional C algebra. Let B a C linear basis. With unit 1 in the basis. Write AB equal the sum for C in the basis NABC times C. It's always possible because B is a basis. So H is an algebra. So you can make the product of two elements in the basis, it's in the algebra, and decompose into elements of the basis because it's a basis where NABC is a complex number. So you have. Why? This is not free. Wow. Okay, so I should remove that. So, to have a straight line is not free for this application. Crazy. Anyway. Okay. Okay. Remark. In fact, the algebra H is just linear span, the complex linear span of the basis. Complex linear span of B. You can write it like that if you like. So now, let me define what is an hypergroup. So a five-dimensional H algebra H, five-dimensional algebra H together with the linear basis as before is an hypergroup if you have three assumptions, one involution and one pro two properties involving involution. So a finite dimensional algebra H together with a C linear basis B is called a hypergroup if there is an involution, if there is an involution on the basis, such that NAA star 1 is positive. So if you multiply A by its dual, so here adjoint, I don't remember in fact if we call that dual or adjoint. Dual, yes. So A star, you make the multiplication, A star, you have a decomposition, and the multiplicity here, it's not really a multiplicity in general because it's a complex number, but this number should be positive for C equal 1, the unit. Okay, and NAB1 should be equal to 0 if B is different from the dual of A. Be careful when I say dual of A star, this has nothing to do with when we talk about the dual of a fusion ring, of the dual of an hypergroup. This is two different dual. Yeah, the dual of an element and the dual of an hypergroup, or the dual of a fusion ring, which is two different notion of dual. So, in fact, the element of the basis in the framework of a group are called standard element. In the framework of fusion rings, they are just called basic element. Will use the notation of hypergroup, but in fact, basic element will be more easy. So an element B, the element B are called the standard element of hypergroup HB. So the hypergroup, so you have the algebra and the basis, which is fixed. So you know the hypergroup like that, HB. Or you can just note H or just B. I will write a sentence about that. It depends on. Maybe you don't always want to write HB. If there's no confusion, you can just write H or just B. Anyway. And here for as a recall that a fusion ring is an hypergroup with some extra property. A fusion ring is a hypergroup such that for all A, B, C in the basis, you have that the coefficients are non-negative integer and you have n I a star 1 equal a a star a 1 equal 1. Here is just positive. For ring, we need it to be 1. And here it is just a complex number. For fusion ring, it should be non-negative integer. So you see how the notion of fusion ring is stronger, is more specific than the notion of hypergroup. Be careful. We may refer to B or H only as hypergroup. In fact, the pointed fusion ring is an hypergroup course. Yeah, so here, wait. The C linear basis, it's C algebra, the fusion ring. It's not exactly like that because fusion ring, it's a Z module. Here, hypergroup is defined as a C algebra. So, in fact, because of that, so here there is a little detail. The fusion ring is defined as a Z module, free Z module. Here, if you say it's an hypergroup such that we have that, it will be still a C algebra. Because you have that, you can restrict C to Z. It's a free Z module. Anyway, it's just a detail. We may refer to that only as a hypergroup. Well, H or B is implicitly understood. What I mean by this sentence is that sometimes I will say let B be an hypergroup or let H be an hypergroup. So I just mentioned the basis or just the algebra, but in fact you should understand that. But the other component of that is implicitly understood. So it's just to simplify the notation. Okay. So which remain 18 minutes. Check the sound again. It's okay. So now we can provide some adjective related to hypergroup. Hypergroup B is called symmetric if n AB1 equal n BA1. Okay. So we are only interested in the coefficient involving one. Okay. An hypergroup is normalized if the sum for C in B and ABC equal one, so it's everywhere, it's for all AB. So for all AB, the sum for C in B of, for all AB, this sum is equal to one. So this sum is just the sum of the coefficient here. That should be one in the normalized case. It is called real if n ABC equal R for all ABC again, rational if this is rational and real non-negative if this is no. And finally, it will be called abelian if AB equal BA for all So everything is for all ABC. All ABC. ABC in the basis. OK. So we have one, two, three, four, five, six notion. Yeah. So it's not, we don't put that randomly, but we will specifically prove some results. For example, this case, we will use this case very often in the course. OK. Symmetric, normalized, real, rational, real non négative, ABD. OK. So, in fact, we will, as I said, often consider real non-negative hypergroup or abelian real non-negative hypergroup. So it will be convenient to use some abbreviation ARN hypergroup mean abelian. So you can have, sometime I will write ARN or just RN. So this notation permit to define the two abbreviations in one time. So real non-negative hypergroup. Real abelian, real non-negative. OK. And just for your information, for your information, RN hypergroup may be called table algebra in the literature. Table algebra in the literature. Yeah, so I wanted to say something. When you say we refer only to B to H, for example, when you consider the pointed fusion ring, so it's Z, G. In fact, this is so this fusion ring corresponds to the group. In fact, when you consider this fusion ring, in fact, with most of the time you just write G, you just write the basis here. A pointed fusion ring is a group. So it makes sense to say in some contexts we only need to consider the, we can write some, only the basis, only the algebra. Because in the trivial sense, trivial case, group case, I'm not talking about representation, I'm talking about the, I'm not talking about Z, not, I'm not talking about character object. Anyway, so, okay. Okay, so now, we will consider a normalized algebra and prove a very tiny, very small result. In fact, in the paper, it's not even proved, but maybe it's convenient to prove this small result here, to be more familiar with the notation. So we will consider a normalized algebra. So let H be a normalized hypergroup. Okay. Let, so here I said, so we can use H of B. Yeah, I use B because we, this is what we used. Here I use H because we will use H. More convenient to say H. So let mu 0 from the hypergroup H to C be a linear map, be the linear map such that mu 0 of A equal 1 for all elements in the basis. Okay. So it's a remark, I don't know how to say that, remark. Mu 0 is an algebra map, the morphism of algebra. Mu 0 is a morphism of algebra for some straightforward reason, but let me prove that. So it's already a linear map, so we just need to check the multiplication. So mu 0 AB equal mu 0 of the sum for C in B n ABC C, which is by linearity. So by linearity equal to the sum for C in B n ABC mu 0 of C, which by definition mu 0 of C is 1 by definition of mu 0, so by definition this is equal to the sum for C in B of NIBC times 1, so nothing to write. But this is equal to 1 because the hypergroup is normalized. Normalized. Okay. But then 1 is 1 times 1 is mu 0 A mu 0 B, which is equal to mu 0 A mu 0 B by definition again. So prove this remark. We prove it's a linear map and mu 0 AB equals mu 0 A mu 0. Okay. So the map mu 0 is called the augmentation map. So we may use this notation the rest of the course. Maybe it's not, I don't know, maybe it appears in the literature or something like that. It's not clear why we should write, we should introduce this notation, but anyway, so okay. So you put every element of the basis, every standard element with the previous notation map to 1. You make the linearize that to H, and it in fact Morphism of algebra called augmentation map. Now, involution on the basis induces the star element structure on the finite dimensional algebra H. So it is semi-simple and it decomposes into matrix algebra. Now, the involution on the induce star algebra structure on the finite dimensional algebra H. So H is semi-simple. It's very well known that a finite dimensional star algebra is semi-simple. Fact, a finite dimensional star algebra is a finite dimensional von Neumann algebra. And any von Neumann algebra decomposed into factor and finite dimensional factor are matrix algebra. This is the shortcut to prove that, but otherwise you have some more general statement in algebra. I don't remember the name. Wittenberg or Wittenberg theorem. Okay, so it's semi-simple. Decompose like that. Is isomorphic to a direct sum of matrix algebra. MNIC. Or some index set with dimension of H is the sum of ni squared. It's not an extra thing. Okay. This is immediate by this isomorphism. So that dimension the complex is equal to the sum of n squared. Okay, so okay. So I guess the course the finish in 2 minutes. So I have no time to write the next point. So let me just talk orally. So you have this decomposition into matrix algebra. So you can call each of this matrix algebra a block. So you have it's even if you each element here can be written as element in this block, and each block corresponds to a matrix algebra like that. Now, each block, if you consider the identity on this block, the identity here is not the identity here because it's something which is one on the block and zero everywhere. Or it can be a block in the middle or something one and zero, zero. This identity is called central primitive idempotent. So the central primitive idempotent. Central mean it only involve block like that. Primitive means you have only one block. You can have a central idempotent if you consider several blocks. But if it is central primitive, it's only one block. And idempotent means a squared equal a. So in fact, central primitive idempotent, the set of central primitive idempotent are exactly the set of identities on the block, on the component, and zero everywhere. Okay, and we will consider some specific tomorrow we consider some specific block here corresponding to the augmentation map. okay. So, I guess we should stop here. So this line mean we will stop here. I will stop here and if you have question, so now I will stop the Zoom because it may be used by someone else. So if you have question, please ask. You can ask on the WeChat group or you can ask on the Zoom, but next time, because now I will stop the Zoom.